Hello, this is Tina here from Under 3 Acres, and in today's video, I'm going to be sharing with you some tips on starting a gluten-free prepper pantry. First off, I want to welcome you to my channel. If you haven't already subscribed, please hit that subscribe button. And if you aren't new here, I'd like to say thank you for supporting my channel and welcome back. If you aren't new here, you know that I make lots of videos on all things gluten-free. We're a large gluten-free homesteading family, and being gluten-free is something that I have to do. And I'm assuming that if you are here today, it's because you or a loved one has to eat gluten-free. I've been meaning to make this video for some time now. It's really near and dear to my heart. In March and April of 2020, we had a really hard time sourcing food for our large family. We relied mostly on the grocery store, and we didn't have a lot of food stored at home. Not a lot, like we had some, but not a lot. And I canned a bit of stuff, but not enough to sustain ourselves the way we needed to. And it showed me that we weren't prepared. It became kind of like a full-time, I mentioned this in other videos, it was like a full-time job just trying to get food for our family. There were things like eggs that they had strictly limited or weren't in the stores at all. And we luckily found someone who went outside the city and brought eggs into the city from the Hutterites. And so we started buying from the Hutterites. And we'd already been sourcing our meat and mostly from local farmers because of gluten. And we knew farmers who had made sausage, for example, that were gluten-free. So that was okay until everybody started running on them because the meat was out in the grocery store. Today I'm gonna show you, I hope to help you, start your own gluten-free prepper pantry. It's so important if you are, this is coming from my depths of my heart. It's so important because when this happened to our family, I felt so unprepared. It's not like we could go to the food bank and get food from there or have some friends, you know, drop some stuff off. When you're gluten-free and you get very sick at the lightest trace of gluten like I do, or like some of my kids, you need to be prepared. I don't want this to be a really heavy, dark video. In light of that, I've put together a list of 14 things that I think would really help you get a kickstart on a prepper pantry. The first thing is dry goods. This is like gluten-free flours, things like beans, rice, quinoa, like the gluten-free grains, gluten-free pasta if you can eat it, nuts and seeds like pumpkin seeds, sunflower seeds, hemp, dried or dehydrated fruits like raisins or cranberries, and even vegetables. Like you can dehydrate vegetables from your garden to put into soups and stuff like that. These are all really great things to have in your pantry. Now you have to be careful because some gluten-free flours will go rancid. It's not like wheat berries, like if you're, you know, can eat gluten and they keep forever. Some grains like gluten-free grains like flax seeds, for example, if you have those, keep them in a fridge or in a freezer. We like to stock up on flax meal, I think is what it's called, ground flax, and I put those in the freezer. I don't even store those on a shelf. So just to be on the safe side, because the bread we make contains flax, and so I don't want to be caught without that. So the second thing I would like to mention are spices and flavorings. If you do stock up on a lot of rice, you're going to want to have ways to flavor it. I find that having we get the Bragg's soy sauce, I think it's aminos, I think is what it's called, and we like to have salt is another big one. All preppers have salt, so like that's one thing that we like to get, like the bigger containers of it. Some other things are spices. Not all spice blends are gluten-free, so it's really, really important to find spice blends or anything that you, if you have like Sloppy Joe mix and stuff like that. We avoid a lot of that stuff because I've got kids with other allergies. So if you're gonna buy those kinds of things, make sure that they're gluten-free and you can stock up on those. Those keep for a really, really long time if you can eat those sort of things. Another thing is bouillon or broth. You can either make your own or you can stock up on the gluten-free ones as well. To make everything have a bit of flavor, right? If you're gonna be stocking a lot of rice and things like quinoa, you're gonna want a way to flavor them. Next. If you have kids, number three for me, and it's like right up the top because condiments, my kids put ketchup on everything. So we have to make sure we have gluten-free ketchup in the house. We have mayonnaise. All my grocery hauls, pretty much, we have mayonnaise. We have things like mustard and salsa. I'm trying to think of anything else like that that has a really good shelf life. But condiments are a really big thing in our house, so those are really good things to have. And kind of on the same line would be spreads. So things like peanut butter or almond butter. I have one kid that can't do almond butter or peanut butter, so we have sunflower seed butter, jam. I make lots of jam. I've got lots of videos on that too. And things like butter. And we tend to stock up on butter and then just freeze it. Sweeteners. You are gonna wanna make sure that if you have, like if you're gonna be canning or anything like that, you're gonna wanna have sugar, you're gonna wanna have honey, you're gonna wanna have maybe some maple syrup, or if you do something like agave, xylitol, or stevia, like whatever it is that your gluten-free sweeteners are, you're gonna wanna stock up on those. Most of those don't go bad for a very, 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 very long time. So the next thing I would stock up on is water, obviously. In your 72-hour emergency kit, you know, there's websites that tell you what to have in that. Water is always number one. Here we've had the power go out at least 3 to 4 times since we've moved here. We haven't even been here a year. And when that happens, our water pump doesn't work. So I like to have water. I also like to have juice for the kids. I bought some cases of juice boxes. Like they had 24 little juice boxes for $5. So I stocked up on those because those are nice to have because you still need to drink even if the power's out. We also stock up on lots of coffee, lots of tea, and other like specialty drinks. If you drink like hot chocolate or iced tea, and I'm trying to think of any other ones, pop, or if you put those drips that you to flavor water, those are also really, really good to have, and it makes your water taste like something if you did have to go for a long time without. We also have a Berkey water filter so that we're not in any way without water. We just have to source it then maybe from outside. The next thing, I'm coming from like the point of view, like I'm a mom, I've got little kids, and so this is something that's near and dear to my heart. And if you have kids who are gluten-free or have celiac disease like we do, you're gonna wanna have some safe snacks. It's all great to have tons and tons of rice, but I'm telling you, those beans and rice are gonna get awful sickening. And if you have little kids, it's nice to have some things that are fun. I like to have things like some gummy bears or nachos, crackers, things that are snacky foods that they can eat in the event of a power out even. And go, oh yeah, granola bars and applesauce. I've made tons of applesauce this year. You can watch that in some of the videos that I've made. Those are all great little snacks for kids. There's things, other things like fruit jerky, or yeah, fruit, I just mixed it. Like jerky, beef jerky, or like turkey jerky, and then there's fruit leather, so I have fruit jerky. but anyway, you get the idea. Pickles, that kind of stuff. Stuff that kids can snack on or are great to have. Oh, and don't forget things like chocolate chips or marshmallows if you wanna make some snacks. Like if you have the ingredients, you can make muffins, like chocolate chip cookies or muffins or stuff like that. After the snacks, let's get to like the meat and the bones of things. So let's talk about meat. I like to have lots of canned meat. Some of it I pressure can myself. Some of it I buy in the cans when they go on sale, like tuna, salmon. We also do chicken and turkey and ham. You just have to check the ingredients to make sure. Some of them are not gluten-free, so you'd want to make sure that they have no weird, funky ingredients, because we found sometimes they have like weird ingredients and then you're not sure. If it says like things like, I say weird ingredients, I mean like natural flavor. What does that mean? Where does it come from? Sometimes you can call the company and they'll tell you what that is derived from. I've had companies tell me it comes from corn. Well, we have some corn allergies, especially in broth. The natural flavoring in broth is often corn, as well as caramel color is often from corn, or could be from gluten things, or yeah. So just make sure you check your labels. Eggs or egg alternatives. If you're gonna be without power, or if there's some kind of, you know, situation where you are needing to have to make things, so you've got all the flours, you've got those, now you want to collect some things that you can do with them. So you're going to need either eggs. So if you don't have backyard chickens, you can either get like these powdered egg alternatives, or you have flax. You can do flax eggs or whatever it is that's safe for you to have eggs. You could also water glass eggs. That's where you put them in, I think it's calcium hydroxide. I might be wrong there. And you put your eggs in there and you can preserve them for a really long time and still be able to cook with them later. You could also scramble eggs or put them in little silicone dishes or like those silicone muffin cups and freeze them. What I do is I freeze them in those little muffin cups, the silicone ones, and then when they're frozen, I just put them in a Ziploc bag so that you have eggs at a later date if and when you ever need them. Another thing is canned goods. Okay, so we've talked about the dried things, but canned goods, if you have like canned beans are great, canned soups are great, canned fruits like peaches and pears, fruit cocktail, especially if you have little kids, like anything like that, you can canned vegetables. Like we like to stock up on, you know, carrots and potatoes and beans. And they're great for throwing together a soup really quick or a casserole if you need to, but it's also really great just to stock up on because they keep for a really, really long time. Another thing that you'll see in a lot of my hauls is we buy a lot of fats, oils and lard, and so mostly like olive oil, avocado oil, lard, and coconut oil. Those are the big ones that we like to have so that we can cook, we can flavor things, and it fills you up. If you have little children, like I do, or babies, I've always kept formula. Like I've always breastfed, but I've always either kept breast milk or a bit of formula on hand, just in case. You just never know. There's been times where I've been really sick and I relied on somebody else to feed the baby. Whatever the baby likes to eat, or like our toddler, he has some, you know, favorite snacks that keep well, and I like to keep those in the pantry. So if you have really little ones, it's a good idea to stock up on some of the things that they can eat, whether it's baby mums or, you know, the gluten-free stuff that's safe for them if they need to be gluten-free or allergen-free, as well as formula. I like to have a little bit of that kind of stuff there just in case. You never know. And if you don't need it, that's fine. You can have that. What I've done in the past is if I see, oh, it's getting kind of close to expiry date, I just give it to other friends who have little ones. No loss. Or you can throw, you know, like the baby food stuff, you could just, you know, the chicken in a jar, you can just throw that in a soup. Nobody will know. Another big one for me that is really important is medication and supplements and anything that you need for like indigestion. So I myself, I'm hypothyroid. I make sure that I always have enough thyroid medication on hand if I were, you know, not able to get to a doctor, because I live in an area where we get tons and tons and tons of snow. So if the roads were closed and I couldn't get to the doctor or I couldn't get to a pharmacy, I know that I'm still okay. My thyroid's gonna be okay. I also make sure that we have cough and cold medication that's safe, because in the event that you need it, you wanna make sure that it's safe and it's not gonna make you sicker than you already are. So I always make sure that I have what everybody needs, like for the different age groups, for our family, all the different things that work well for us, whether natural or a little bit stronger stuff over the counter, just because they can sometimes have hidden gluten in them. And I also make sure probiotics, vitamins, those kinds of things, I always like to, you'll see those in my hauls too, I like to stock up on those to make sure that I'm, you know, never running low, and they keep for a very, very long time. The other thing we like to keep in our cupboard is allergy medication, like Reactin or Benadryl. In the event that somebody gets stung by a bee or a wasp, or even like has a reaction to something that maybe had gluten or something in it, we like to also have gravel and activated charcoal. Those are just the things that I like to keep well stocked in our house, because you just never know if somebody gets glutenized. It's not pretty. So you'll know, like if you have that issue with gluten, you'll know. It can be really, really awful. And if you can't find something that's safe, then it's really hard. And the last thing that I want to mention is not a food thing, it's toiletries. Now, I'm really sensitive to gluten, and I know other people who are, cannot use toiletries that have gluten in them. So a lot of shampoos have, you know, wheat bran or something in them that's supposed to make your hair nice and shiny, which is lovely. I love all that stuff. But if it gets in my mouth, I get glutenized. So I avoid shampoos and shower gels and toothpaste and all those things that could possibly have hidden gluten in it. So I stock up on those things, and sometimes I end up making my own hand creams and stuff like that, just to be really on the safe side that I'm not gonna get glutenized. So those are great things to stock up on top of, like toilet paper and, you know, those kinds of things. If you know you react to a certain product, because like some people even react to toilet paper, and I've heard of this before because when we started first researching the corn thing with my son who was really, really sick, and when we found it was corn, some people even react to like takeout cups because they're made from a cellulose that is derived from corn. Like if you know what things, you'll eventually know, or if you don't already know what you're allergic to, so you want to avoid those kinds of things. Out of breath. So that's a lot to think about. These are all the different things that, and I'll put the list on here again of all the different things that I think you should think about and to put in your prepper pantry. Now, it can seem very overwhelming. I know I felt very overwhelmed at first. I felt like, how will I ever be able to do this? Gluten-free things are expensive. So I watch for sales and I will stock up during sales so that when they're full price, I can spend my money on something else that's on sale, and I know that I have enough ketchup or peanut butter or whatever it is that my kids really like to eat or that we need to have in the house. So I can allocate that money and it saves us money in the long run. Another thing is just to double up. If I'm buying one of something, then I might as well buy two and put that in the pantry. And over time, that starts to build up. As long as you can get everybody to understand, it's like just because there's double in the house doesn't mean you need to eat double, right? I've got kids. They're smart. they know, right? And so the other thing I like to do is if we have a little bit of extra cash, like we made a little bit of extra money, or my husband brings home a bonus or something like that, we will use some of that to buy things in bulk. So buying in bulk often makes things cheaper. We've bought pasta in bulk and oats in bulk and rice we tend to buy in bulk. So then the cost is a bit lower and you have things for a longer period of time. I also like to have things that I can put those in. I like to have like the Gamma lids for my buckets. I've got some 5-gallon buckets that are food safe. I've got some Gamma lids on those so that they're good for a really long time. Things like oats, if you stock up on those, you'll want to throw those in the freezer for a while. Just, I know it's really gross, but there could be like bugs and stuff that could hatch and grow in there. I know it's really gross, but we're talking about farms here, guys. Weevils and things, it happens in flour, so I like to just freeze them for a couple days and then they're fine, and then I can take them out of the freezer and it's all good. The other things that I've learned is to not get so hung up on, do I have, you know, 3 months worth, do I have 5 months worth, do I have enough of everything? I don't think any prepper ever feels like they're, maybe, I don't know, I just, maybe I haven't been prepping long enough, maybe they don't, you know, get worried, but you can also get like freeze-dried things in cans. Like you can get cans of freeze-dried eggs or fruits, vegetables, even bacon and eggs. You can get gluten-free things in those cans if you feel like this is something you want to do. I haven't started doing that yet. I really would like to. It's just a matter of funds. It takes a while to build up a prepper pantry, but I'm telling you, if I can do it, so can you. And don't get hung up on how much do I need. Just start collecting a little by little of the things that you eat. Only buy the things that you're really going to use. Just because somebody else stocks up on rice, like for a really long time, we didn't even eat rice because kids, some of my kids still have issues with rice. So when I cook rice, I'm only cooking for half the family. So if you don't, you eat it, don't stock it. And stock the things that you can. And if you have to put them in the freezer, see that you have freezer space to do that. We got a freezer for free off of a marketplace. Somebody was just getting rid of it. So it was just really big and really heavy. So all we had to do was, you know, show up with manual labor and just have a nice, cool, dry place to store a lot of these things, and they will keep for a really, really long time. So I think I've gone on for long enough. I hope you guys have gotten some inspiration on how to start a gluten-free prepper pantry. Maybe I'll do another pantry tour. Be sure to check out the last pantry tour I did. That was pretty soon after we moved here. So since then, we've built up a lot and I've been canning a lot. And you can check out those videos too. If you have any questions about being gluten-free or some things to stock up on or how to do it, just leave some comments below. I read them all and I try to get back within a few days to make sure I answer everybody's questions. And I am going to wish you, I can't talk sometimes and that's okay. I'm gonna wish you guys all the best. Have a great day and we'll see you in the next video. Bye.